In the previous video, we created a demo Spring Boot application which returns a Hello World string on the default path and a basic HTML on the slash index path, and made it live by pushing it to Heroku Cloud. The application we have right now is kind of useless, right? It has no real functionality. It just prints out Hello World. To make this application useful, we needed to talk to a database to store, retrieve, or manipulate data. Spring Data is a Spring project that lets us do exactly that with minimum fuss. Spring Data JPA, a part of the larger Spring Data family, makes it easier to implement the data access layer for our application. JPA or Java Persistence API is just a Java specification that is used to persist data between Java object and relational database. JPA acts as a bridge between object-oriented domain models and relational database systems. It provides a platform to work directly with Java objects instead of using SQL commands. ORM tools like Hibernate provide implementation for this JPA specifications. In this tutorial, we will be using PostgreSQL, a relational database. You might wonder, why Postgres and why not any other relational database like MySQL? Simple. Heroku provides a free Postgres add-on with considerable storage for a demo application. And who doesn't love free stuff? Heroku provides a hobby dev plan that is absolutely free. To integrate PostgresDB into our Heroku application, use the command Heroku add-ons create Heroku PostgreSQL colon the name of the plan. The database has been created. We can check the info regarding our Heroku application using the command Heroku info. It shows the Postgres hobby dev as an add-on. We can see it shows up in the dashboard as well. Click on it to open the database details page. Under the overview tab, we can see the constraints like maximum number of rows and connections allowed in this free plan. Under the settings tab, we can get the database credentials like DB host, username, password, port, etc. We can also get the same info from Heroku CLI using the command Heroku PG credentials URL database. We have provisioned a database from Heroku for ourselves. In this database, we are going to have a category table with category ID, subject, and exam type, and a question answers table with a question ID, category ID, question and answers columns. These two tables are connected by foreign key constraint on the category ID. We can use the psql commands to log into our database and run queries to create our tables. For this, we need Postgres installed in our system. Install Postgres from the link provided in the Heroku Postgres page depending on the operating system you are using. We can establish a psql session with our remote database using Heroku PG psql command. And we can run queries in it. Or we can use a desktop client like DBWare, which is a universal database tool, to run queries on the Postgres DB. DBWare supports all popular relational databases. Download and install DBWare. Once installed, open DBWare and create a new connection. Choose PostgreSQL. And in the connection setting dialog box, fill in the database credentials which you can get from the Heroku CLI. Inside the database, there is a schema named public by default. We need to create our tables under this schema. We can create our tables using the DBWare user interface by filling out column names and their data types, and adding constraints like primary key, foreign key, not null, etc. Or we can write the DDL or data definition language queries ourselves. I have already formulated the DDL queries to create the tables. The category table has category ID as its primary key and subject and exam type as type varchar, and created and last updated timestamps as timestamps. Let's execute this query. The category table has been created. The question answers table has question ID as primary key and category ID as foreign key. The question and answer columns are varchar. Execute this query as well. The tables have gotten created with a foreign key constraint on the category ID. The tables don't have any data now, so let's insert some data. I have prepared a set of insert queries. If you're too lazy to create your own insert statements, don't worry, I'll provide all the queries used in this video in the GitHub repo, whose link you can find in the description below. You can use that. So let's execute these queries. The data has got inserted. As discussed earlier, for a Spring Boot application to talk to the database efficiently, we need Spring Data JPA. So we need to add the Spring Boot Starter Data JPA dependency and also the PostgreSQL driver dependency in our pom.xml. Spring Data JPA is just a data access abstraction used to reduce the amount of boilerplate code required to implement data access layer. Next up, we need JPA entity beans, which are nothing but ordinary Java classes annotated as entity. These classes represent the underlying table structure. In our database, we have two tables, category and question answers. Hence, we would need two entity beans. We also require repository interfaces, which represent the data access layer, which typically does all the database operations like find, save, persist, etc. Spring provides the implementation for these repository interfaces in the runtime. Instead of writing SQL queries, we just need to define query methods in our repository interfaces, and Spring will derive the query from the method name directly. You can see on screen some of the supported keywords and naming schemes for the query methods. Typically, in Java, we would require to provide the implementation of these repository interfaces, but Spring takes care of the implementation in the runtime, and we just need to define the corresponding interfaces and methods. Creating entity beans and JPA repositories manually is a cumbersome task. Hence, I use the IntelliJ plugin JPA support to generate the entity beans and repository interfaces. Go to Settings from IntelliJ toolbar, and in the Plugins section, you can add this plugin. We will create a new package named data for the JPA entities and repositories. To use the plugin, open up any class and use the shortcut Alt-Insert. In the drop-down, select Generate JPA Entities, and in the dialog box that appears, fill out the database credentials. Provide the newly created data package as the entity package and repository package. The classes will get generated in the provided package. Uncheck Use Lombok. Click Next. It shows you the list of tables in the database. Select All and start generate. The entity beans and repositories got generated under data package. You can see that the entity beans are Java classes marked with entity annotation and mapped with table names and column names using table and column annotations. The repositories are just interfaces extending JPA repository, which in turn extends paging and sorting repository, which provides us with a set of methods to manipulate or fetch entities like save, find all, etc. The ID annotation on category ID denotes that it is the primary key field. There are some changes we need to do to these generated entities. Marking a field with generated value annotation specifies that a value will be automatically generated for that field. This is primarily intended for primary key fields, and the identity strategy indicates that the field will be incremented using the database server-side strategy. The created and last updated timestamps are of the data type timestamp in the database. So instead of having it as a string in our Java object, we will change it to local date time. Annotate the created timestamp as a creation timestamp, which will set the property value to the current date time when saving the entity for the first time. Also, annotate the last updated timestamp as update timestamp, which will set the property value to the current date time whenever the entity is updated. Do the same changes in the question answers entity as well. The current question answers entity doesn't reflect the foreign key relation on the category ID. To do that, we need to replace the column annotation with a combination of join column annotation and one-to-one annotation. Also, replace the string category ID with the entity bean category. This indicates that the column category ID on the question answers table refers to the primary key category ID on the category table. Refactor the getters and setters accordingly. We now have a data access layer and a controller layer. For these two layers to interact, we will introduce a service layer which will provide the business logic. Service layer provides separation of concerns by separating the business logic from the data access layer and the controller layer. Let's create a package named service. Create a class named QuestionBankService and annotate it as a service, which indicates that this class provides some business functionality. The best practice for service layer is to separate the abstraction and implementation. So we will create an interface named iQuestionBankService. And make the question bank service implement this interface. Our end goal in this video is to fetch all records in both tables. So let's create two method definitions. One, fetch all categories, which returns a list of category objects. And two, fetch all question answers, which returns a list of question answers in the iQuestionBankService interface. Implement these methods in the service. We need to add the repositories as properties in the service to talk to the database and fetch data. We will add the AutoWide annotation to this repository property. Spring's AutoWiring feature enables you to inject the object dependency implicitly. AutoWide annotation will tell Spring to search for a Spring bean in the Spring container, which implements the required interface, and place it automatically into the setter. Since Spring provides the implementation of these repository interfaces in the runtime, those implementations will be injected into this service class. JP repositories by default come with a findAll method, which can be used to fetch all entries from the tables. We now have our service layer. We need to invoke this service from the controller class. I will create a separate controller for API calls named QuestionBank API Controller. This controller is only meant for REST API calls and will not be used to render UI. Hence, we will annotate this as a REST controller, which is a combination of controller and response body annotations. REST controller indicates that the data returned by each method will be written straight into the response body instead of rendering a template. I'll add a request mapping slash API to the class to add a base path to the API requests. Add a request mapping slash questions, which returns the list of all questions and answers, and a slash categories mapping, which returns the list of all categories. We will inject the question bank service by auto-wiring either the interface or the implementation itself. Auto-wire searches Spring Beans in the Spring container by the reference type. We can use the injected service to invoke the corresponding fetch methods. You would have noticed that we are returning a list of objects in both the methods. This list of objects will be serialized to a JSON while returning the response. This is because any Spring REST controller in a Spring Boot application will render JSON response by default as long as JAXON2 is on the class path. JAXON2 transitively gets included in Spring Boot Starter Web Dependency. One last bit of configuration we have to make is adding the database credentials in the application.properties file. We have to set the Spring data source URL, which is the JDBC connection string, and the data source username and password. Let's run this application. On the /API/questions path, we are getting a JSON array with the data from the database. Similarly, on the /API/categories path as well. Now we are successfully able to fetch data from Postgres database using Spring Data JPA. When pushing to Heroku remote, it is not advisable to store the database credentials in plain text in the application.properties file. Heroku injects the database credentials as environment variables when a dyno starts up. If the Heroku app has a database add-on, we can make use of these environment variable placeholders in our application.properties while pushing to Heroku remote. We can externalize our configuration by creating separate profiles for dev and prod environments and having separate application.properties file for each environment. Let's commit this code and push it to Heroku remote. Let's check Heroku logs to see if the application is up and running. Use Heroku Open to open your remote application. It is fetching the questions and categories from the database as expected. That's it for this video. In the next video, we will be building our UI layer using Bootstrap and Thymeleaf. The GitHub link is provided in the description below. You can check out each lesson by choosing the appropriate branch. Thanks for watching, and we'll see you in the next video.